to a new episode of Hammer D20, the show that wants to take your face off. I hope you know that reference, because you know, that would be really creepy if you don't know that reference. It's gonna make me look kind of. Steven, editor, help! Put the clip.
I'd like to take his face off.
Okay, good. There we go. Got to make sure I got the clip. Because my name is Steven Solbot, and I will be your guide. Today, we're going to take a look at one of the newest films that has just come out, The Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent, a film where it stars Nicolas Cage playing the greatest character ever live, Nicolas Cage. But before we get to that, I'd want to go through a bit of his filmography to help understand more as to why he is who he is. Because, I mean, how do you have a film whose main selling point is that it's Nicolas Cage playing Nicolas Cage, right? There has to be a reason why that's appealing. I mean, like, where do I start? Do I need to explain who he is? Well, I mean, like, Nicolas Cage is a Hollywood actor who's been acting since the 80s. And is the nephew of world-famous director Francis Ford Coppola, director of the Godfather trilogy, Apocalypse Now, and Bram Stoker's Dracula. Cage is arguably one of the world's greatest and most famous actors, with a big emphasis on the arguably, because in addition to that, he's also arguably one of the most polarizing actors. People having difficulty deciding whether he is a good actor or a bad actor. Because if you haven't seen him in a role, well, you're missing out. Because Nicolas Cage is Nicolas Cage.
Well, then fine! If that's what you want, then let's have it out right now! Well, let me guess. It's the wrong time! It's the wrong place! I'm wrong again! Wrong about us! Wrong about Thomas Gates! Wrong that you'd like the Queen Anne
in the right file, according to alphabetical order. You know, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, R, S, T, U, V, W, X, Y, Z! Huh? That's all you have to do!
Open it! 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 Open it!
Now, I know you're not supposed to be playing your cards so quickly as to whether you love or hate him, but I think I might be holding a pair of aces. I believe that Nicolas Cage is a national treasure, pun intended, and that his acting style is the Wicker Man. Is the bee's knees.
Not the bees! Ah!
Boiling him down, seeing him act in scenes is completely refreshing to what the average Hollywood actor tends to do. They tend to try to go for a natural look, where they try to act like real people. They don't want to overact or overreach what they're trying to do. Whereas Cage himself is nothing but. I mean, he tries to be natural sometimes, obviously. But his most notable roles are when he goes big and explosive, and he's now going straight to the camera, and he's like, I'm... I can't even do it right. Can't even do Cage better than anybody else. See, back in silent films, actors didn't have the ability to speak their lines, at least verbally. They had to express their emotions, their intentions, their desires and wants, and their character exclusively through body movement and facial expressions. There wasn't as much of a divide between stage actors and movie actors as there is now. Many movie actors had to utilize stage acting techniques in film, as many were also stage actors, and many believed movies to be a lower form of acting in theatrics, as, quote, made for the masses. If you watch a classic film, like The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, you can tell what the actors are thinking and feeling, even without the subtitles that appear or the music that accompanies it. They use their body to express fear or strength or curiosity, emotions and feelings that take talent to express physically. I'd say Cage is an actor that tries to rekindle that acting technique of the silent era, using expressive body actions and facial expressions to convey what he's trying to do and express. He's even gone on to say that German Expressionist films like Cabinet and other early silent films like Nosferatu or Metropolis have been inspiration for his acting style. I obviously mention this because it's a plot point in Massive Talent. And, I mean, at the minimum, which actor has a compilation of clips such as this?
Okay, you know, I've had it with your drama, Lavinia. So do me a favor and get the f*** out of my sight, okay? No, actually, I'll save you the trouble and get the f*** out of yours.
So even at the basic level, he's an actor who tries to do something different, and that, to me, at least has some creative credibility. That doesn't mean he's perfect. As a matter of fact, I would say the opposite, because in recent time, Cage has been nothing but prolific, having appeared in over 100 films over 40 years. But since 2010, he's been in 43 different films of varying success. Some good, others not so good. And why is that? Well, back during his heyday, during the 2000s, although he was one of the highest paid actors, he went into extreme debt, having purchased many things and collectibles and superfluous luxury items like vehicles, property, and notably a dinosaur skull. It is reported that he owned over 15 personal residences, 22 automobiles, including 9 Rolls Royces, a flotilla of yachts, a private jet, and other quantities of valuable jewelry and collectibles. He's also a massive comic book fan, and back before his overspending period, he had a sealed copy of Action Comics number 1. You know, the expensive one. But who would spend excessive amounts of money on collectibles that has no real value other than just being there and just gathering dust? So anyway, eventually the bill came to the door, and he had to pay it off by liquidating a lot of the assets that he had accrued over the years, usually at a fraction of the cost that he paid. To pay off the remainder of the debt, he had to take on many film roles, no matter the quality of the film. Now, I'd love to just jump into the unbearable weight of Massive Talent right now, but I feel like if you're going to fully understand what I understand about Nick Cage, you need to understand the films that had led him all the way up to 2022. So, without further ado, I feel like we should start with one of his earliest films that many people know as the meme film, I guess you could say, Vampire's Kiss. Vampire's Kiss is a dark comedy film where Nicolas Cage plays Peter Lowe, a literary agent who falls in love with a vampire. He believes that he himself, after being bitten, is turning into one as the film goes on, and his lust for this vampire woman grows more and more, turning him from slightly crazy to absolutely unhinged. If you're a fan of Cage's work and haven't seen Vampire's Kiss, this is required viewing for your homework for tonight, as this is quintessential Cage, one of his craziest performances that he's ever done, in a film that's pretty okay, where the appeal is him and exclusively him.
Alva! There you are!
His role as an 80s work-driven Wall Street yuppie is tinged by this unusual accent that he adds, which causes him to be the butt of the majority of the jokes.
I still wouldn't ask that person to partake in such a miserable job as long as you were around. That's right, Alva. It's a horrible, horrible job. Sifting through old contract after old contract. I couldn't think of a more horrible job if I wanted to. And you have to do it. You have to, or I'll fire you. Do you understand?
Critics hated this film, and this film was a box office bust back in the day. They quoted much of his acting was sucking the life out of the film and described as scorched earth acting. And yet, without it, you're left with an unusually mild tale of addiction to a parasitic love. It's still a relatively unique story, but if he had anyone else playing his role, it wouldn't stick out. it's probably more of a case of the film industry and audience not being ready for it, instead of the lacking of a film quality, because I love this film for all its quirks. And as you know, I am the penultimate voice in objective film critique. I do believe that audiences now would receive Vampire's Kiss better than they did before. And I mean, the proof's in the pudding. Many of the scenes from this film were converted into internet memes about a decade ago for Nick Cage's outlandish facial expressions and his actions throughout this film, whether they knew the film or not. So, long story short here, if you're ever wondering why Nicolas Cage has a cult following, Vampire's Kiss is probably the perfect example of where that stems from. And with that, I feel like we're best to move on to one of Nicolas Cage's best performances and best movies he's been in, and one of my personal favorite films, Face Off. Fast forward 9 years, and we're met with a different but similar Nick Cage. One that at this point won an Academy Award for Best Actor in 1995 for his performance in Leaving Las Vegas, and is now starring in big budget action films and dramas. Films like The Rock and Con Air were some of the biggest action films of the 90s. Explosive movies with massive over-the-top premises like breaking out of Alcatraz or commandeering a plane of escaped convicts. It all demonstrated Cage's career at this point, as he was the box office draw. This was his prime, and although he wasn't always the craziest, he certainly was something that added to the film's appeal, as these films were almost a little frenetic in their own way. All this accumulates into Face Off, the 1997 action thriller where FBI agent Sean Archer, played by John Travolta, has to assume the identity of criminal mastermind Castor Troy, played by Nicolas Cage. Archer has a personal vendetta with Troy, as he killed his son and aims to take down the terrorist or die trying. Troy reveals that he's got a bomb planted in Los Angeles, and to learn its location, Archer has to undergo an experimental surgery which replaces his face with Troy's, and go into the prison to meet his brother and learn of the bomb's location. Meanwhile, Troy, who was captured during the takedown and put into a coma, prematurely wakes up and takes Archer's face and starts acting as Archer, taking control and manipulating the FBI to his will. I mean, where do I even begin with this? It's one of the most action-fueled films ever, where it replaces reality with wonky science, glaring plot holes, and explosive fiery action scenes, all accumulating into one of the most enjoyable films of our time. It's one of director John Woo's first North American productions, a director famous for his over-the-top action scenes and addiction to adding doves flying through fight scenes. Both characters play intense caricatures of the other, where Travolta's acting like a volatile creep, while Cage is acting like a stoic sane man. Yeah, kind of. Overall, Face Off is definitely one of those films that represents the 90s era. Extreme plots that don't always make sense, but cool things happen, and it seems like the director had fun making it. And for me, it's one of my favorite films ever made, and definitely my favorite Nick Cage film. He isn't as crazy as he is in Vampire's Kiss, but he certainly hits a lot of those marks that we've gone to love and see. And with that, I think we're going to take a short break before we move on to his prolific debt era. We'll see you soon, in a minute. Welcome back. So, we spoke about Nicolas Cage's early acting career, as well as his prime, and a bit of his slump. But I think it's time to talk about what I would call the renaissance of Cage's career, which is accumulated into...
Sometimes we just want to...
Mom and Dad. A dark comedy where Nicolas Cage plays Brent, a normal run-of-the-mill father who's in a dead-end job and a dead-end marriage where a static natural instinct kicks in all people in the world, and every parent starts killing their own children for the sake of the world's self-preservation. They don't intend on murdering other people, though, and treat the action as just something we gotta do, just another day, just another dollar kind of thing. Cage and his wife Kendall, played by Selma Blair, basically team up to kill their own children, while their children fight them off and try to keep them from killing them. It is extremely violent, dark, but kind of funny in its own way. There are scenes that really drive the point of the film home, like when a group of dads are staring at their newly born children in the hospital waiting for the nurse to give them their child, their bloodlust being showed without actually being shown. Wonderfully powerful and a big draw of this film. And to top off the whole experience, Cage is in one of his wildest roles, acting as wildly as expect him to, flailing around violently, screaming for his children, and envisioning his wonder years of stuck in this miserable life are all things he really pulls off well. He's pretty much the villain, but is also the main center of attention, showing scenes of him rekindling his relationship with his wife during their murder spree, and creating an unusual dichotomy where you're not sure if you want him to succeed or not. Obviously, you don't want him to, but, like, that doesn't look very good on my part. But anyway, this is a quintessential example of his prolific debt era, where it's a film that is mediocre or just okay, but the film has an interesting concept, and Nicolas Cage fits that concept well. He encircles the weirdness of it and makes it into almost his own genre of film. Maybe he was selling out, and for understandable reasons, but he never gave up, which is why I still say Nicolas Cage always has a bit of artistic flair and artistic merit still left in his body. Which brings us to our feature review, The Unbearable Weight of Massive Talent, which for simplicity's sake, let's just call Massive Talent.
Is it too much?
Is this supposed to be me? It's grotesque. I'll give you 20,000 for it.
Massive Talent is an action comedy where we follow Nicolas Cage, the famous Hollywood actor who at this point is past his prime and struggling to rekindle his old fame. He feels like he's in a bit of a rut in his career, and like he's never going to get out of it. In the beginning, we see him awkwardly grovel for a big role in a film that's basically Othello, and the director pretty much doesn't have any interest in his audition. He's followed by a younger version of himself, Nicky, Cage's inner monologue and youth that he's mentally personified as his manic and wild version of him that wears a leather jacket and has that hair swoop that he used to have, and screams out and overacts a lot of his lines. Young Nicky is the encouragement that drives him to rekindle his old fame, telling him that he's the best and he's the greatest actor ever. This helps define current Cage as an egotistical, self-absorbed, washed-up actor that many people believe Cage to be, as he's also struggling with his home life. He's divorced from his wife and his estranged daughter, who has already determined that he only cares about him and not her. While at the psychologist's appointment, he claims how much she means to her and how they have so much in common. But she says they aren't, and they keep forcing his own personality onto her. This is demonstrated through him forcing her to watch The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, a film that is one of his personal all-time favorite films, but is one that she has no interest in. His agent, played by Neil Patrick Harris, tells him that he's got an offer to appear at a birthday party in Spain for $1 million. Cage isn't interested, seeing as it's a sellout kind of thing to do. Harris says he knows he's in massive debt, and his paycheck might be a quick and easy way for him to get out of this debt. Cage still rejects the offer, saying that the new Othello film will be the thing that gets him back on his feet. After hearing his rejection from the film audition, Cage gets drunk and ruins his daughter's birthday party with an awkward song about how much he loves her, just embarrasses her and everyone at the party. Cage then dramatically calls the agent, saying that he'll accept the birthday party appearance, and claims that he's quitting acting. Defeated, Cage travels to Mallorca, where he plans to meet his client. Upon arriving at Mallorca, we're met with two CIA agents, Vivian and Martin, played by Tiffany Haddish and Ike Barinholtz, respectively, who are spying on Cage as he's exiting the plane, surprised to see him and not the person they're chasing after. They appear to be hunting down a criminal, but after seeing Cage, they feel like something's off. Either way, the field agent Vivian concocts a plan and greets Cage like a fan, planting a tracker on him as she's taking a selfie with him. Cage then travels down to the villa of the client Javi, played by Pablo Pascal. Javi is a super fan of Nicolas Cage and a bit of a nervous, nerdy guy. He wrote a movie script for Cage to read, hoping that they'd want to work with him on the film. This whole birthday party thing is a bit of a scheme. Cage's agent didn't send him the script, though, knowing that it'd be garbage and that he's not interested in it. Either way, as Cage is recovering from jet lag, Javi sits down with him, and his cousin Lucas and assistant Gabriella join them, where they ask what he's working on next. He declares that he's quitting acting, which pushes Javi to take him on a journey to a cliff overview, where he's acting out a scene from, something. But it's from Con Air or something similar. Either way, Cage isn't too enthused about waking up so early to have some superfans spout action lines to him, but Javi isn't giving up on him. As he says, if you turn your back on that gift, his acting, then you're turning your back on the entire human race. Cage finally breaks down and plays along, puts him in his actor mode, and jumps off the cliff with Javi. After that exhilarating jump, they start connecting, where Javi starts asking him about his life and his favorite films, which really opens Cage up to him. Connecting through their love of film, Cage agrees to look at the film that Javi has written. Just before the night ends, Cage is kidnapped by the CIA, where they reluctantly get him to spy on Javi and find out the location of the kidnapped daughter of the president of Catalan. Javi's apparently kidnapped her to sway the president of Catalan in favor of supporting mob rule and mob actions, keeping the daughter as coercion and ransom. From here on, Cage teams up with the CIA to try to find the kidnapped girl and take down Javi, but Cage finds it hard to believe that this geeky superfan could be a crime boss. As he tries to discover the truth, he instead gets closer to Javi, leading to frustration, betrayal, and a thrilling action scene. I obviously spent a lot more time writing that intro than I did those last paragraphs, not because exclusively that I wanted to rush through it so that we didn't run out of time, but also because the best part of the film is kind of understanding what happens in the actions that the characters play. It's kind of hard to describe a joke in this film without doing it injustice. You know, it's hard to get the inner minutiae and the little details the film captures in this character drama. Saying that Nicolas Cage's inner monologue is being a volatile and sporadic being doesn't do it justice. It's exactly what you remember Cage being like back in the day, and you'll just have to see it to believe it. Pedro Pascal is such a good, awkward little character that's just unhinged enough to be frightening and believable to be possibly a drug lord, but is also someone who could just be a superfan who's spending their days with their idol. Cage and Pascal's interactions are great and pretty natural. The best parts of the film are between these two. I'd say my favorite part of the film is during the, quote, drug trip, where Cage and Javi are taking their film to a town square where they're trying to discuss the themes and events that happen in their film, and Cage sees a pair of old men talking at a bench and says that maybe they're looking for them the whole time, like they've got a bit of a paranoia scene. Javi gets paranoid himself and thinks that Cage is being serious, where Cage kind of falls for his paranoia. Javi keeps looking at them, getting more and more paranoid, while Cage says to calm down and to kind of put some subtlety next time he looks at them, telling him to do a fake laugh at a story he just told. Javi, understanding him, turns and stares at the men and laughs at them awkwardly. Boiling it down, the film kind of is like a parody of a James Bond film, and when you think of the details that it hits, it works and almost acts like a 90s-era Pierce Brosnan film. You've got elaborate parties, the tech-based espionage, the car chases in the end, and a general happy ending. Even the filming style and panning shots of the scenery seem similar. Maybe it's just because those Bond films are utilizing common filming standard techniques, and this film does the same, but it's just kind of feels more similar than most other film types. If you ask me, the film's strength comes from its first two-thirds. It kind of falls apart a bit near its last third. Where in this last third, it kind of turns into a generic action comedy with blundering gunfights and car chases, like something you'd see in The Other Guys. The great thing about this is that while this film has a great affection for Cage and his work, you don't have to be a mega fan to appreciate it. It's pretty self-contained and character-driven, as Cage's sadness and excessive debt has now been solved, having been debt-free as of this year, and the film portrays a fictionalized version of him that people imagine him to be. Again, you only need to know him as a washed-up Hollywood actor, and that's kind of all the details you need to understand of him. Would I recommend it? Absolutely. Is it my favorite Nick Cage film, though? No, not a chance. Face Off is still definitely my favorite of his films. This film's probably more of a 7 out of 10. It's pretty good, definitely, and you'll enjoy it, I'm certain of it. whereas Face Off is a 9 out of 10. If you don't enjoy it, that's fine. That's whatever. But it's definitely a film that really hits where I want a film to hit. And so with that, I think that's all I need to say. I hope you've enjoyed this deep dive into Nicolas Cage's filmography, and that even if you don't go to see Massive Talent, yeah, you might want to check out some of his older filmography. That's all the time we have for Hammer D20. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you... Whoa! Later!